sail across the channel, we could hear the roar of their engines and sometimes see their silhouettes dark in the sky above us. The sea was rough, the wind cold, the hours eternity. But the order of the day still sounded in our ears. To us is given the honor of striking a blow for freedom which will live in history. And in the better days that lie ahead, men will speak with pride of our doings. Let us pray that the Lord mighty in battle will go forth with our armies and that his special providence will aid us in the struggle. Let us go forward to victory.
Further north, the aircraft of Bomber Command were orbiting above a phantom fleet in the Straits of Dover. To make the Germans believe our attack lay there, they circled all night, dropping clouds of tinfoil, which registered as an armada approaching Calais on the German radar screens. The enemy's radar along the Normandy coast lay broken, recording nothing. And they first knew our fleet's position when they saw it in the morning.
We saw land in the first light. It was quiet and unreal. Bomber Command had plastered the shore batteries before dawn, but all the same, there was bound to be someone at hand to welcome us. Engaged the remaining coastal guns, shells, bombs, rockets were loosed against the beaches, and our landing craft moved in to the assault. Our fighters gave continuous cover, but the Luftwaffe never appeared. Our only air losses were from shore-based flak. As we approached the beaches, our fighter bombers flew in to give close support, directed by control ships to their targets. It was a long, rough ride in the assault craft. It got worse as it went on. Then we hit the beach, and we were there. Our beaches were codenamed Gold Sword Juno. We attacked with one Canadian, two British divisions. Away to our right, three American divisions were fighting their way ashore on beachheads Utah and Omaha. The battle spread 50 miles along the Normandy coast. Everywhere we met resistance. We'd have made a wonderful target for the Luftwaffe, but the Luftwaffe had been pushed out of the sky. In a few hours, we had a firm footing ashore. We were tired, we were cold, we were under heavy fire, but we were back in France.
This is London. London calling in the home, overseas, and European services of the BBC and through United Nations Radio Mediterranean. And this is John Snaig speaking. Supreme Headquarters, Allied Expeditionary Force, have just issued communique number one, and in a few seconds I will read it to you. Communique number one. Under the command of General Eisenhower, Allied naval forces, supported by strong air forces, began landing Allied armies this morning on the northern coast of France. This ends the reading of communique number one from Supreme Headquarters, Allied Expeditionary Force.
Before D-Day ended, reinforcements took off from Britain to support the airborne troops who had been fighting for hours against German pressure on our flanks in Normandy. Another wave of Allied planes set out across the channel. 250 tugs and gliders, escorted by 15 squadrons of fighters.
By the time the gliders landed, a considerable battle had developed around the 6th Airborne Division's bridgehead north of Caen. Our paratroops were faced with heavy counterattacks by the 21st Panzer Division, the only German armor to appear on D-Day. Within a day of our landing, all three British beachheads were linked, and the Second Army held a continuous front.
Within a few hours of the landings, work began on the Mulberry Harbour at Aramanche, and by June the 19th, the new port was in service. Its prime mover, Winston Churchill, had joined the expeditionary force by then to see for himself the result of years of effort. On D-Day plus 10, the King of England set foot in France. And as his news went round the world, the heads of state and heads of services reviewed their plans for the next phase of the war. A foothold in Normandy was not enough. Before the campaign of France could roll forward, bases had to be built for the whole tactical air force. Squadron after squadron left England for Europe. Among them, the Lorraine squadron of the Fighting French.
For 4 years, we have served in exile, in the Middle East, in North Africa, in Britain. Now, we are going home. We are going to finish the battle where it began in 1940, in the sky above France. This time, as we fly across the channel, we see something unusual. The British call it Pluto, the pipeline under the ocean. It will bring us oil and petrol when we are based again in France.